Thank you for the nice introduction. So I would like to use the next 30-35 minutes in this afternoon slot to talk a little bit about how to keep Apache Flink going reliably and efficiently. A bit of history on this talk. I gave it first at the Apache Flink training at Flink Forward San Francisco earlier this year. It was just meant as a little talk to give people an overview how to operate Flink as part of the advanced training track. But people were so happy about this talk and were resonating very well with it that I decided to turn this into a talk so that people can learn basically what we've learned over the past 3 to 4 years working with users on the mailing list mostly, but also internal customers on how to debug Flink, what are the common issues, what are the things that I think people should know they don't know all the time. So it's a subjective selection of things that I think are important to consider when moving a Flink job into production or when doing performance evaluations with Flink. And I'm going to, as a red line in this talk, have a job that an imaginary job that we're going to deploy, and then I will run you through the different tasks that you need to consider from planning to deployment in the end with that job. So the first topic I'm going to talk about is capacity planning. So I'm going to do an example back of the napkin calculation on how to figure out how many resources you'll need to deploy a certain job, given a certain set of hardware that you have available. Then I'm going to talk a little bit about some deployment options and best practices and some ideas around configuring Flink correctly. So let's dive into the capacity planning part first. So I recommend before you put something in production or before you start a streaming job on your cluster, think through the resource requirements for your problem. So think about the number of keys that you have. Think about the state per key that you have. Consider the number of records that you're expecting to arrive in your system every second. And also consider the size of each record. Take into account the number of state updates that you have. So what is the access pattern on RocksDB or the Heap state backend? And also figure out what your SLAs are. What downtime can you accept? What latency are you willing to accept? What do you expect as the maximum throughput? And on the other hand, of course, also, what are the resources that you have available? What is your network capacity? And also take into consideration any external service you're talking to. So if you're talking to Kafka, of course, you have to consider what network traffic Kafka is causing. If you have replication enabled, for example, this replication will cause network traffic between the brokers. If you have HDFS, you will send your file not to one machine, but to the number of replicas that you have for your file. So all these are factors that you should consider. And based on these facts, you should then establish a baseline for your deployment so that under normal circumstances, you should be able to avoid back pressure. The operation should be going smoothly. And then add a margin for recovery. So if the job fails for some reason and you're restarting the job, then of course you will use more resources because you're catching up from your Kafka topic. So you will have to have some additional resources to also catch up to the latest offsets in Kafka. And also take into consideration the checkpointing itself. And checkpointing and window operators cause spiky loads, as you'll see now in the example. So to visualize this a little bit and also to give you the opportunity to learn some details about Flink and how to approach such a back-of-the-napkin calculation, I'm going to run with you through a little example where we basically together calculate the expected disk network access pattern for this job. So let's consider we have a very simple Flink streaming job that is reading from a Kafka source. Then we are partitioning by user ID so that we can build a sliding window of 5-minute size with a 1 minute slide. So you will get results every minute out of this window, and this minute will do an aggregation over a time span of 5 minutes. And we're using the RocksDB state backend to store these aggregations. And the result of this is going to be written to Kafka. So the expected data is going to be 2 kilobytes per record. Maybe it's like a JSON string or something. The throughput is 1 million messages per second that we are receiving. We have 500 million users, so we have 500 million distinct keys. And in our window operator, we will do an aggregation over 4 longs. So we'll just keep, let's say, a count and average or whatever. And we need to store 4 longs in this window operator. And the checkpointing frequency is set to only 1 minute. So this is implies that the SLAs are quite relaxed. We are willing to accept a recovery time of up to 1 minute, basically, because we can lose 1 minute of state and need to reprocess this 1 minute in case of a failure. And my boss gave me this hardware. So I got 5 machines. They're connected with 10 gigabit Ethernet each. And the machines are just running a task manager and nothing else. Disks are attached via the network, which is quite a common pattern, for example, on AWS Cloud, where you use like a block device attached via the network. Kafka is completely separate. The disks are completely separate. So let's just assume we have 10 gigabit Ethernet to each machine and to Kafka and the NAS. It's basically unlimited. So this is the setup. And now let's run some numbers. So to do this, I'm suggesting to just look at one machine in your cluster, not to look at all machines. Just look at one machine. And as I said, the machines are connected with a 10 gigabit Ethernet connection, full duplex. So we're able to receive 1.2 gigabytes of data per second, and we are able to send out at a rate of 1.2 gigabytes per second. And within this task manager, these operations are running, or that are happening. And so first the Kafka source is running, then there's this repartitioning step, then the window operator, and finally the sync that is emitting the results periodically every minute. So let's first understand how much data is getting into the system. And that's 2 kilobytes times 1 million. So we have 1 million records per second. That makes 2 gigabytes per second that come into the entire 5 machines cluster. If we divide that number by 5 so that we know the individual throughput per machine, it's 400 megabytes per second that each machine is receiving from Kafka. Next, we are going to key by. So we are going to shuffle the data over the network so that all the events from one user end up on the same machine. So for almost all records, they will have to cross the network. So we have the 400 megabyte per second stream, and we divide it by 5 receivers. So we have 5 machines in total in the cluster, which makes 80 megabytes per machine. But as you see here, one receiver is local, it's just ourselves, and the 4 other receivers are remote. So we have 320 megabytes that we're sending out to the network, to the 4 other machines, and 80 megabytes that we are just processing locally in the window operator. So these 80 megabytes are basically just the users that are running on the same machine, so we don't need to cross the network. This also means that the 4 other machines are sending us 80 megabytes per second each. So we have 320 megabytes that we are receiving from the other machines. And now the question, what is the window operator emitting? So how can we find out the throughput of this window operator that Kafka is then going to, that the Flink Kafka sync is going to send to the Kafka cluster? The answer is 67 megabytes per second. And to show you how I came up with that number, let's go into an excursion. So the question is, how much data is the window emitting? And as I said in the beginning, when I was telling you the data of the job, we have 500 million unique users, which means for this that we have 500 million unique keys. So we need to store 500 million times 4 longs and the user ID. So since we have 5 machines, we can divide these 500 million unique users by 5, which makes it 100 million users that one machine is going to process. And the size of the state that we need to store per user is 40 bytes, because we have two integers, the user ID and the window timestamp, so the time when this time window started, plus the four longs, which makes 40 bytes in total. So every machine is going to emit 4 gigabytes of data every minute. And if you divide 4 gigabytes through 60 seconds, then you have 67 megabytes per second that each task manager is emitting. The problem is this is not the entire truth, because it's emitting every minute. It's not emitting over time. So this is a spiky load. It will process for 59 seconds, and then it will burst for a few seconds because this window is triggered and is emitting the data. I will come back to that later. So, the final result. We have 720 megabytes of incoming data and 380 megabytes of outgoing data. Is that correct? Who believes this number is correct? Who believes that we need to continue with the calculation? Okay, so the last ones were right. It's not the final result. So we forgot the disk access to RocksDB via the network attached disk, and we forgot the checkpointing, which is also going over the network. So the question is, we have disk reads for this window operator because we are using the RocksDB state backend. So the state, these 100 million times 40 bytes that we have per window, is stored not on the heap, but it's stored on disk using RocksDB. And in order to understand the amount of data that we are transferring for the window operator, we have to look at the number of messages that we are receiving every second. So we have 1 million messages per second, and we are maintaining a sliding window of 5 minutes with a 1 minute slide. The window operator in Flink is internally implemented in a way that if you have a sliding window, we will have multiple windows for each slide that we are maintaining. So we have 5 windows with an offset of 1 minute each, so that we can compute these sliding windows. So every minute, one window is being computed, dropped out, and another window is being created. But for every incoming record, we need to retrieve the current counts for a user. So we need to retrieve 40 bytes. Update the aggregate, and then write the result back to RocksDB. And this we need to do for all the 5 windows that we are maintaining in the operator. So we have 40 bytes per key, and by having 40 bytes per key, 5 windows to maintain, 200,000 messages per second, because we divide 1 million through 5, we have 40 megabytes per second that we need to retrieve from disk for getting the current aggregates, then we update them in the code, and then we're writing the result again to RocksDB. So this is the updated result. We add 40 megabytes in, 40 megabytes out for the network attached storage. And then there's the third excursion, which is checkpointing. So as I said in the beginning, we've set checkpointing to 1 minute, so every minute we need to copy the entire state of this application into a remote file system. So to come up with a state size per machine, we have the 40 bytes of state, so the 4 longs plus the 2 ints, times 5 windows, times 100 million keys, because we have 500 million keys in total, 5 machines, which makes 100 million keys per machine, 20 gigabytes. And if we checkpoint every minute, that's 330 megabytes per second. So this is then really the final result of 760 megabytes in and out per second. So we are utilizing a bit more than 50% of the network for this example. And I was also curious, what kind of switch do you need to run this? So if you have a rack and your boss asks you what kind of rack do you want me to buy, and what kind of switch do you want in the rack, and the result is 10 gigabytes per second that these machines are exchanging for this computation. There is, though, a little disclaimer. that I would like to add to this back of the napkin calculation, because I didn't consider the overhead of the protocols. I didn't consider the Ethernet overhead, like each Ethernet frame has a header, TCP has X that it's sending, Flink has an RPC system that sends messages. If we are talking to a file system, this file system also makes RPC calls, like before you write a file, you tell, oh, I'm going to write a file, give me a stream. So there's lots of thingies going on at the same time that I didn't put into this calculation. But it's still, I think, a good rough estimate to get an understanding of the kind of hardware that you need to use and the kind of performance you can expect just from a theoretical point of view before you actually start experimenting. And then I hope that you also learned some details about like the window operator and which numbers to consider for coming up with this calculation. So going back to our job. So now we have done our planning. We know how many machines we need to buy, and we have understood the performance that we can expect. So the next thing we want to do is we want to deploy it. So let's quickly look into deployment options of Apache Flink. Flink comes with a Hadoop YARN integration, which is quite helpful to get started quickly. So all the big Hadoop vendors like Cloudera, Hortonworks, and MapR in their virtual machines, but also in the thingy that you download and install on your cluster, come with YARN pre-configured. So it's quite easy to just download the Flink binaries and get started with Flink. The cloud providers, Amazon EMR, Google Cloud, they also provide YARN clusters for you. So basically at Amazon, you just click once and then you have a YARN cluster available. And as of recently, well, since 1 year or so, Amazon is also providing Flink in the package repositories of these virtual machines. So you can just do sudo apt-get install Flink, and then you have Flink on your disk to use it. But of course, we also have integration with Mesos and DCOS, so you can just, with a click of a button in DCOS, roll your own. And there's a talk tomorrow about Flink in Containerland that I recommend to attend, where we are going to talk about an increasingly popular deployment option, which is basically the standalone mode within Docker containers, which gives you a lot more flexibility and I think is the way to go these days in the world of containerized infrastructures. Next, there's a pretty important topic about your state backend. So once we've decided how to deploy, we also need to decide where we are going to store the state. And there are three main state backends, and I think RocksDB is the default that I would recommend. So the state backends basically distinguish themselves from the way where from the place where they store the working state and where they store the backup of the state. So RocksDB is keeping your work set, like in my example from the calculation, the window contents or the aggregates, it's keeping that stuff on disk. So RocksDB is just a library that has a special file format, and it's a database that lives on your hard disk. So in the case of the RocksDB state backend, it's just using the temporary directories of the node that runs the task manager to keep your state. And then you can basically use state that is larger than the available main memory. And the state backups are sent to the distributed file system or just the state backend that the state store that you're configuring. The snapshotting in RocksDB can happen asynchronously and synchronously. I would recommend to use the asynchronous snapshotting. It also supports incremental checkpoints, which means you don't have to send the entire state every time you do a checkpoint. You basically only send the changes since the last checkpoint to HDFS. It's a bit like incremental backups. So instead of backing up all your data every time, you just back up the diff. And this is how the RocksDB state backend saves the time on the checkpointing, because the network pressure is lower on sending the data away. But since RocksDB runs on disk, usually it's slower than a memory-based state backend, because you need to serialize and deserialize the data to store it on disk. So each record goes to the serializer to store it on RocksDB. You need to access the disk to retrieve the data. So it's a bit slower than the file system state backend, but it's also much more reliable because you are not bound by the available heap space. And so the pressure on the garbage collector is much lower, and you have more memory available for your user code. If you need something really fast and you have small state, then I would recommend the file system state backend, which has a misleading name because it's storing the state on the JVM heap. So it's just objects living on the heap. So there's no serialization in between. You can just access the reference, get your data, do your changes easy. Only when you're doing a snapshot, so when you're doing a checkpoint or a save point and writing the state to the state backend, you will have to serialize the contents from the heap to the disk. But it also supports synchronous and asynchronous checkpointing. And then there's a memory state backend, which is more or less like a debugging tool. It's storing the state in the JVM heap, and on backup, it's storing the heap in the JVM of the in the heap of the job manager. So it's just in memory, but it's still nice for local debugging or high performance use cases. I've mentioned asynchronous checkpointing multiple times. So I would like to quickly show you how Flink is doing the checkpointing. So you have a few threads involved in this, and the upper thread is the main processing thread. If the line is green, this thread is making progress. It's accepting data. It's calling a user function, doing the processing. And then whenever the checkpoint coordinator decides to trigger a new checkpoint, it's launching a new thread that is going to do the checkpoint. So this thread is going to wait on the lock of the state, and whenever the user function is done with processing, it will lock the other thread and will start copying your data, snapshotting your data into the file system. So if you're backing up this data to S3, for example, and S3 is down, it will start retrying. Or if there's any other thing happening in the network and it's slow, you cannot continue with the regular data processing. So it's going to stop until it gives away the lock again and you can continue with the processing. And this is where asynchronous snapshotting is really powerful, because it's, again, another thread that is waiting for the lock, but this thread will then just very quickly, for RocksDB, basically save an internal time ID, and then the main thread can continue processing, and the snapshotting or checkpointing thread in the background will copy all the data from RocksDB asynchronously into the file system, which basically makes you independent of external system failures or some issues that slow it down, and your main processing can continue. I mean, of course, you have a performance penalty because you need to access the disk from multiple threads, one thread that is doing the processing, one thread that is doing the copying, but it's still very, very powerful. And we have the same also available for the FS state backend, which keeps the data in memory. By using a copy on write kind of hash map internally. So we will internally, if you access a state that has not been yet backed up, we will create a second copy on heap so that we can still do a backup, which is really powerful if you have like a slow deserialization or if the external system is slow. So I would recommend to enable this. It's available from Flink 1.3. To wrap up the deployment section, I would like to quickly make you aware of the production readiness checklist on our website, because it contains a few important pointers to things you should consider before putting something in production. One thing to consider is the max parallelism configuration parameter on the stream execution environment. It allows you to set the maximum parallelism that you can rescale to. So if you set a max parallelism of 128, which is the default value, you can only rescale up to 128 parallelism. The problem is Flink is using some virtual partition, some virtual parallelism. It's called key groups internally. So if you set an insanely high number just for fun because you don't know what's happening in the future, then you will pay a performance and state size price for it. So I would recommend to carefully choose this value for rescaling, for future changes in your workload. Then in the same topic of restoring, set UIDs for all operators. By default, Flink is generating unique IDs based on how the topology of your streaming application is written. But as soon as you're changing this topology, Flink doesn't know which state belongs to what operator because you've changed it. And Flink has this set UID or UID method in the API that allows you to just give it names, just a string. And then Flink knows, oh, this state belongs to that operator, but that operator moved a little bit, but it knows how to assign the state to the operators. And the last thing is that in Flink 1.3, we introduced new interfaces called list checkpointed and checkpointed function, which allow you to use features like rescaling and more advanced state access. So the checkpointed function is like a generalized function that you can use to hook in and use like external database transactions and stuff. So it's pretty powerful, and I would recommend to use these new interfaces. All right, so much for the deployment. So now we figured out which state backend to use, how to deploy the stuff, and the next question is, how do we tune the job so that we use the available CPU resources efficiently, and how to use the cluster resources efficiently. And the main configuration parameters to do that is the parallelism and slot configuration. So these settings influence how work is spread across the available CPUs in your cluster. So a slot is basically one processing unit or one processing pipeline that is available, that is offered by a task manager to the cluster. And I would recommend by default as an approximation to use one CPU per slot or one slot per CPU. So if you have four CPUs, offer four slots. But it could also make sense to have multiple CPUs per slot. So if you, for example, have a heavy use case with a lot of state and you have an asynchronous state backend, you want to have one CPU for the processing and one CPU for the checkpointing in the background. But this really depends on your job, and I cannot make a general statement about it, but I would like to explain you a little bit what to consider. So one thing to consider is operator chaining in Flink. So if you have in your streaming application multiple map operators that have the same parallelism and there's no partitioning in between, the engine will merge these operators into one task. This is what we call operator chaining. In Spark, it's called stages. It's a pretty common performance optimization, leading to fewer records being serialized, and the handover between the threads is not necessary in this case. Another thing is then the concept of slots. So if you look at the at Flink at a high level, to the operating system, a task manager is just a process in the operating system, and a task slot or the task is a thread. So within a task slot, one or many threads can run. And Flink is using an optimization called slot sharing to assign tasks to these slots. And by default, all tasks have a common slot sharing group, which means that all the tasks are allocated into the same, into one slot. So if you have, in this example, two task managers with three slots each, then you have a total of six slots available, and you can run your application with a parallelism of up to six. So you see that, for example, in the leftmost slot, you have the source with a chained mapper. Then there's repartitioning in between. That's why this window operator is running separately. And then you have another repartitioning because the sync is running with a parallelism of one. So the scheduler of Flink has scheduled the entire pipeline of this job into this first task slot. For the remaining slots, it has also allocated the entire pipeline. But it didn't allocate or didn't schedule the sync because it's running with a parallelism of one. But if you want to have a very customized setup where you know that one operator is extremely expensive, then you can also specify in the API slot sharing groups. So you can specify a name, and then Flink will schedule these into separate slot sharing groups. So it's schedule everything in one slot sharing group, except this one thing with a different name. So this way you can also influence how Flink is distributing the tasks across the cluster. So there are many things you can do. You can configure the number of task managers. So you can maybe deploy multiple task managers on each machine, or you can deploy fat task managers with many slots, depending on your needs. You can specify the number of slots per task manager. You can set a parallelism per operator as well. So you can set like a global parallelism, but also a per operator parallelism. So in this example, the sync was running with a parallelism of one. And you can control the operator chaining behavior. So you can also configure that the chaining is completely disabled, which means that all the operators are running individually, which makes, for example, metrics and monitoring easier because you see the metrics for each task individually. The next item is the memory configuration in Flink, and I'm going to run you through this on the example of Yarn. So the thing with Yarn and many other resource managers is logically that they're enforcing an upper limit on the memory that you can use. So on Yarn, you request a container of 2 gigabytes, and Yarn is going to enforce this limit. So if you're going 1 megabyte over these 2 gigabytes, it's going to kill your process, which is something you don't want. So we have to somehow come up with a mechanism to control the maximum size of our JVM process. And within the JVM, there's not just the JVM heap that we can limit using the XMX parameter. So XMX basically tells the JVM, your heap size is kept at a certain amount of memory. The problem is that Netty, for example, that we're using for the data transfer between task managers, or RocksDB, which is using in-memory caching through a configuration parameter, is allocating memory outside the heap because RocksDB is using JNI, and I guess Netty is also using JNI to do like malloc in C, and then it's outside of the control of the JVM how much memory the process is going to actually use. And if you think this is an ugly slide, the next one is even uglier. So as I said, the container limit is specified by the container request size. So in my example, we have 2 gigabytes of memory for the Yarn container. So the JVM process has to stay at all costs below this. And what we do by default is that we have a configuration parameter called the containerized heap cutoff ratio, which is by default 25%. So this means that if you have a 2 gigabyte a container allocated, then we'll tell the JVM, don't go with your heap over 1.5 gigabytes. This works based on our experience. There are some tuning knobs also for what happens inside the heap. So the memory manager is used for batch processing, for the network, for the buffers where we keep like the data from the joins and the sorting and so on. And the network buffers are also allocated on the heap. But most importantly on the heap is your user code. So if you have a heap state backend, like a FS state backend that stores the state on the heap, then this is going to eat up your heap space here. So you have to take this into account. And if you're using a custom RocksDB configuration, so because you maybe know that you have a lot of memory available and not so much memory used in heap, you can actually change this. So you can change the containerized heap cutoff ratio to a higher cutoff, so to basically just say give 1 gigabyte of the memory to the heap and the rest of the memory to RocksDB and let RocksDB cache the data, because then you can drastically reduce the disk access of RocksDB, because RocksDB is keeping the stuff in memory. So you can play around with these parameters if you know how they affect each other. The last item I would like to talk about is checkpointing. So there are some configuration parameters around checkpointing. The most important one is a checkpointing interval, which tells you how frequently Flink is triggering a checkpoint. But there are some tuning parameters that allow you to control this even finer. So you can, for example, configure a min pause between checkpoints. So if you want to make sure that Flink is always making some progress and not spend all its resources on checkpointing your data, you can also tell the system, okay, please always do at least 10 minutes of processing before you trigger the next checkpoint. So you can basically also say, set the checkpointing interval to 0 and set the min time between checkpoints to 10 minutes. So this way you guarantee that you're always processing for 10 minutes and then you're creating a checkpoint. So it's a more dynamic model. Because it could happen that the old checkpoint hasn't been completed yet and the next one is already waiting to be triggered. Then you can configure checkpoint timeout. By default, it's 10 minutes. But it might make sense to say, OK, I don't care. If a checkpoint didn't go through after a minute, I just cancel it. And you can configure concurrent checkpoints. So if you have a super crazy application that takes hours to checkpoint, it might make sense to have multiple checkpoints running concurrently. So if you everywhere use asynchronous state backends, then this might make sense. I'm running almost out of time. So I just want to show you this slide, the usual suspects. This is the mental checklist that I have when somebody asks on the mailing list, oh, my job is slow. Then I'm going to go over this list and check these factors. So what are the data types you're using? What serializer are you using? Are you using Afro? Are you using Protobuf? Are you using Cryo? Did you register your types for Cryo? Are you using a custom serializer? This is all stuff to consider. And in my opinion, in my experience, most of the time, serialization goes a pretty far way to improve performance. Because as I said, for each RocksDB state access, you need to serialize. For each network transfer, you need to serialize. So everywhere, serialization is involved. Then inefficient data flow graph. You saw in this calculation how much data we transfer over the network for each repartitioning. So this is expensive. So maybe we can remodel our problem in a way that we can save a bit on repartitioning, or at least reduce the data size a bit before repartitioning. Then there might be slow external systems. Maybe we have a map operator that is querying a database. And if you're querying a database for each record, your throughput is basically limited by the speed of the external database. Since Flink 1.2, we have a blocking I/O operator that helps to mitigate this. So it can interleave these external calls. And of course, slow network, slow disks. So do your homework, do the math beforehand to understand what actually is possible on your environment given certain configuration parameters. And that's it. I hope you enjoyed the talk. I hope you have some questions left.
You didn't tell anything about job managers and I mean high availability stuff. So
yeah. So this talk is pretty long if I go over all the stuff. But I have some slides on high availability available. basically the message. So this is all in the documentation about high availability. There are many options for HA. So in Yarn and Mesos, HA is basically built in. So in the Yarn case, we just run one job manager. And if this job manager fails, the resource management framework, so Yarn, will start a new job manager. And then Yarn will tell this job manager, these were the machines that were running. And Zookeeper will tell, this is your last state. So it tells the job manager, this is the last checkpoint, this is the last state. And then this job manager can pick up work. But in the standalone mode, you can also implement HA using Docker containers or whatever you're using. And there you can also implement a model where you have like standby job managers. So if you have, here in this example, we have three job managers available. If one job manager crashes, one of the standby job managers is going to take over and become the new leader. The only requirement that we have to enable this is Zookeeper, which takes care of leader election and also stores some metadata for the new job manager to understand where did the old job manager leave. So HA is built into Flink and works well. I mean, almost everybody who's seriously using Flink in production has some kind of HA somewhere. There's another question.
Thanks for the talk. With that amount of importance on the serialization, can you give perhaps a little bit best practices, what serializers to use and what the common pitfalls are? You were just briefly using one sentence on that, but if it's, let's say, 80% of the mistakes, perhaps you can spend two more.
Yeah, the problem with this is it's extreme. I couldn't come up with a general rule of thumb thingy because it's so diverse. I mean, for every data type, for everything you need, you have very different serializers. But so one thing, for example, that I sometimes see is that people have like a Kafka source that is deserializing strings, and then they have a mapper after that that is parsing the JSON in the string to some kind of record. And if you just look at this pipeline, then for each record coming in, you're allocating a string in the JVM, then you're passing the string to the mapper. The mapper has to, so sometimes people even create like a new parser for each record. So it's instantiating a parser, it's reading the string, and then it's creating maybe a JSON node from the Jackson library, which internally has a hash map, and the hash map is serialized using the cryo serializer, which is again expensive because it needs to go over all the fields of the hash map. So it's pretty expensive. What you could also do is use the JSON deserialization schema in Flink, which just takes the byte array from the Kafka consumer and parses the byte array. So you don't need to allocate a string in between. You don't need to, in my calculation beginning, allocate 1 million strings per second in your JVM. So your garbage collector is, of course, going to burn. So you can skip this string allocation. You can just immediately pass, using the Jackson library, the byte array. And then maybe you don't go and send the JSON node from the Jackson library over the wire. Maybe you can just use the fields that you need, put them in a tuple something, or put them into a POJO, and send this downstream. And this goes a long way. I think then you don't need to call cryo and all this stuff. Speaking about cryo, if you don't have the type registered, cryo will, when serializing, so if you have, I don't know, my cool company class, will write the entire name of this class every time an object is serialized. So maybe you're sending most of the time just strings with the class name over the network. What cryo has is this feature where you can register a type, and then cryo is just sending an ID for this. So instead of sending a 20-character string with each record, you're just sending one integer of 4 bytes. So this is the kind of things to look into when looking into serialization.
I have a question. How is the checkpointing made high available? So I think if you, I'm talking about RocksDB, is that, you know, so what if it, let's say, gets killed?
Yeah, I mean, that's the reason why Flink is sending the checkpoints to persistent storage. So if you have 5 task managers running and each has the window contents, then every minute, every task manager is sending basically a large blob to this persistent storage. And if one of the task managers fails, they can just, everybody resets to the last valid checkpoint. So everybody downloads the file from this persistent file system, reinitiate basically from that point, and then start reading again. And all this happens in an exactly once fashion because also the consumer, mostly the Kafka consumer, continues or starts reading from the offset at that point in time.
But that persistent file storage then also needs to be high available because if it's not
yes.
There.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, if you're using Amazon S3 or if you're using HDFS, they're replicating. But if you have a better solution, I'm happy to hear it. But this is commonly the pattern to just replicate your stuff, and this way you make it fault tolerant. Yeah. There's another question over here.
Hi, nice talk. Just wondering if there is any work being done regarding OFIP state backends.
There's no. I mean, RocksDB is OFIP because it's not on the heap; it's on disk. But you're talking about direct memory, like direct byte buffers being allocated outside the heap.
Like Apache Ignite, for instance.
Yeah. We have some thoughts on that. It's not, we're not immediately implementing this. But it would have a bunch of benefits, yes, I agree. It would be a much more compact representation of the data, and we would have better control over the garbage collector. The thing is, Flink has all this infrastructure from the batch APIs. So there we are using, we have an option for off-heap that we are using, for example, when you have a sort merge join and you need to sort a data set, then we're using off-heap memory. Or if you have a join, like a hybrid hash join, which is implemented in Flink, then the build side is also kept off memory. So Flink has all the infrastructure to serialize and deserialize into off-heap and also to access keys in a serialized form. So all this is available. I think we are way over time, so if maybe one last question and then I can take questions personally offline. Cool. Yeah, thanks a lot.